The December roster for the US's December 17th friendly against Bosnia has dropped. And guys, it's a pretty good one. We're gonna get to see a lot of guys that we wanted to see. We're gonna get to see some guys that I think were really deserving of a spot. But more so than any roster, this roster needs a lot of context. A lot of the inclusions and omissions have reasons behind them, and we're gonna dig into them today on this video. What up, guys? I'm Pete Douthit, host of the 11 Yanks Breakdown Show. Welcome. If you're new here, hit subscribe. We cover all things in the American soccer landscape. If you're not new, if you've seen my videos before, don't forget to smash like. Let's dig in. Okay, so before we dig into the roster, Gregg Berhalter recently talked to Bobby Warshaw on the US Soccer Podcast, and Bobby asked him about this camp and what was his intent and purpose for it, and Berhalter said this. If we're going to use MLS players in the January window, we need to keep these guys moving. If you think about Ricardo, Pepi, Jesus Ferreira, some of the guys that their teams didn't make the playoffs, their last game will have been the Jamaica game, and that's a long time ago. We need to keep them moving, and then so the objective is to use that time to train and keep these guys fit, and the second objective is to look at some players we haven't seen yet. Incorporate two different objectives into the same camp. Now, most of you probably already know this, but just to clarify, the European-based players were not available for this roster because they are still in the middle of their seasons. This is not a FIFA window, so we are not allowed to call up anybody. The clubs have to give permission for that to happen, and naturally, most clubs don't want that to happen. In fact, I think the only European player who's here is Bryan Reynolds, who isn't getting any playing time with Roma right now. So it's good to see him here, and I think this is a good opportunity for him. Another thing I want to say about this roster before we get into it is that I don't think we should read too much into who's in this roster in terms of where they stand with Gregg. Like I said, there's a lot of context and nuance that is needed with a lot of the players in this roster, but for example, Paul Arriola is not in this roster. I don't think that means that Gregg doesn't rate him or that Gregg doesn't want him in the roster anymore. As much as I'm happy to see him not here because I think other people will now get an opportunity, I fully expect Arriola to be there in January and to be with the national team in 2022. So just because someone's not in this camp doesn't mean that Gregg doesn't rate them anymore, and vice versa. Just because somebody is in this camp doesn't necessarily mean they're going to be involved with the national team going forward. I think the January camp that they're going to have before the qualifiers is going to be a lot more telling in terms of who stands where with Gregg, and certainly, obviously, whoever's actually in the qualifying roster. Honestly, who's in this camp is a lot less interesting to me than who actually starts against Bosnia. This roster has the potential to put out a great starting lineup, or a terrible starting lineup, or something in between. The guys who have been with the team consistently over the last year, we've seen a ton of those guys. I really want to use this opportunity to look at some of the younger guys, some of the guys with high potential, high ceilings, guys who might be able to contribute to us even in the near future. Now, from everything I've heard, Bosnia is going to be bringing a very young team. I'm not sure if it's under 21 or under 23, and there'll probably be a couple guys older than that in there, but it's going to be very much a B or C squad for Bosnia, which would be a great opportunity to then take the leash off and give some of the younger guys an opportunity in this game. All right, let's dig into the roster and talk about it. We start off with goalkeepers Matt Turner, Gabriel Slonina, and John Pulskamp. I like how young this group of goalkeepers is. Sean Johnson probably would have been here, but New York City FC is still in the playoffs, so that's probably why he's not here. But hey, Gregg could have gone with a Brad Guzan or a Tim Melia or somebody else, and the fact that he went with two really young backups for Turner is good to see. John Pulskamp has only played 6 games this season. He's currently the backup to Sporting KC. He backs up Tim Melia there. He hasn't been terrible in his games. I still think he has a lot of developing to do, but I have no problem with him being the third goalkeeper in this roster. Gabby Slonina didn't really cover himself in glory in Revelations Cup, but he's so young. At 17 years old, there's so much improving he can be doing. He's clearly a young goalkeeper with a very high ceiling, and I'm glad to see him here. I don't expect either Pulskamp or Slonina to play against Bosnia, but I have no problem with them being in this roster and getting familiar with Gregg, getting familiar with the group, even learning from Matt Turner, who from a shot-stopping perspective can teach both of those guys a lot. What's interesting about the goalkeepers is none of them are particularly good with their feet, and so I don't expect us to play out of the back if Bosnia presses us in the game. It's not a big deal, but it's just something to note. I've said it before, but I'll say it again. If we want to be a team that plays with the big boys, that competes for World Cups, that is one of the top 10 consistent soccer countries in the world, we're going to have to start developing more keepers who can play with their feet. All right, fullbacks is interesting. Jonathan Gomez, Kevin Paredes, George Bello, Brooks Lennon and Bryan Reynolds. Can I just say how excited I am to see Jonathan Gomez here? He is still deciding who he's going to represent, the USA or Mexico. He's been in a lot of youth camps for Mexico over the course of the year. While we had only one youth camp, that was the Revelations Cup last month, he did win USL Young Player of the Year. He will be going to Real Sociedad. I hope he stays here in the entire camp. I'm hearing there's a possibility that Sociedad might call him in a little early to train, which means he may not actually be able to play against Bosnia. But the most important thing is getting him into the camp, getting him familiar with Gregg and with some of the senior guys. I mean, look, most of the guys in this camp are not the guys he's going to be playing with. So from that perspective, it's a little disappointing. But maybe Ricardo Pepi can get in his ear and recruit him and be like, bro, my experience has been great. Come be a part of this. We're building something. Backup left back is still a spot that is up for grabs going into Qatar. You know, Anthony Robinson is clearly the number one right now, although even he is imperfect in many ways. But that backup left back spot is wide open. And so this is a huge opportunity for Gregg, for the coaching staff to say to Gomez, you could be our number two left back in Qatar, or even pushing to be our number one left back in Qatar, depending on how you do at Sociedad over the next year. He is going to be playing in the La Liga 2, which is a pretty decent level compared to USL. And it'll be interesting to see how he handles that transition. But overall, I'm just very happy to see him here. Kevin Paredes is another guy I'm really happy to see. Still needs to work on his 1v1 defending. Has largely been playing as a wingback in DC United. They have a sort of a 3-4-3 formation that Hernan Losada plays there. And he's been improving, but he spent most of his youth as a winger. And so the defending in isolation and 1v1 defending is still something that he can work on. George Bello is here as well. I've never really been fully impressed by George Bello. He just doesn't seem like he's improved over the last few years, you know? The George Bello of today feels very much like the same George Bello that was playing for Atlanta 2 years ago. And when a guy like that doesn't show consistent improvement, it's a little worrying, but he's still 19 years old. In this camp, I'd like to see either Paredes or Gomez at left back. I don't really see the point of trotting George Bello out yet again. I'm very happy to see Bryan Reynolds here. Reynolds has not been getting playing time in Roma. Jose Mourinho does not rate young players. I think we all knew that once Jose took over at Roma, that spelt the death knell for Bryan Reynolds, who was actually getting regular playing time before that. Hopefully he starts this game and maybe a good performance allows him to get a loan in January. I think that's really the way going forward for Bryan Reynolds, is to get a loan somewhere. Even if it's a loan back to MLS, at some point he needs to be playing. He needs to be competing regularly. That's how young players will improve. And I don't think he's going to get that at Roma. So I'm glad to see him in this camp. And I hope maybe a good performance against Bosnia is something that he can transition into a loan in January. I'm not a huge fan of Brooks Lennon, but the reality is there weren't a ton of right back options in MLS. Most of our good right backs play abroad. Kyle Duncan was a guy that we maybe could have seen, but it sounds like he will be making his move to the Belgian league a little earlier and training with the team. The other guy I could have maybe wanted to see was Jalen Lindsay. I thought he had a pretty decent season with Sporting KC, but overall, I'm not really going to complain about the backup right back here. I think really what we want to see is Bryan Reynolds playing in the spot, and Brooks Lennon is neither here nor there to me. Center backs is where it kind of gets interesting. We brought six center backs. That's Justin Che, Walker Zimmerman, Henry Kessler, Auston Trusty, Kobi Henry, and Aaron Long. Now, I think the big absence here, which is sort of glaring to people, is Miles Robinson. You know, he's not in this camp. Gregg said today that they wanted to give him a load of a break, maybe something of a rest after a long season. I suppose I can get on board with that. For me, whether Miles Robinson is in this camp is really neither here nor there. I'm more interested in what happens with Robinson from January onward. He's in a place now in MLS where he's sort of hit his ceiling. I don't know that he can really improve that much more here in MLS. He is an elite athlete who is very good at defending in 1v1 situations. Still has weaknesses though, right? Don't get me wrong, he's been very good for the national team this year. But those weaknesses aren't really going to be exposed in MLS. Specifically, I'm talking about his reading of the game. I'm talking about his distribution. Those are the two things that I think can still very much improve. I think he needs to go abroad to really be tested and to be pushed in those things. He is going to stagnate if he stays in MLS for the rest of his career. You hit a ceiling at some point where you can't really grow anymore simply because you're not being pushed. And that's my concern with Miles. There does not appear to be any interest, according to Atlanta United, in Miles Robinson. And that's a little bit worrying to me. I think he's definitely a guy who could play in Holland or Belgium or the Championship, maybe even a lower level French team. I absolutely think he could contribute in Europe. and in my opinion, he needs to go. Walker Zimmerman is kind of the obvious choice here. He's the veteran center back. We don't have a lot of young center backs playing in MLS. That's just reality. Long is very telling. You know, the fact that Long has been in the last two camps when he hasn't played a competitive game in almost a year, it says a lot about how Gregg feels about him. Clearly, the message being sent is that Long is going to be involved in 2022. Now, I didn't have a problem with Long being here in the past, but the rise of Chris Richards and Miles Robinson, and even the reemergence of Walker Zimmerman, makes me wonder how necessary it is to continue to bring in Long, who is another guy who's just not that great with his feet, and even has limitations defensively when defending 1v1. He used to do a lot of covering for John Brooks, but going into a World Cup, is Aaron Long somebody that is going to be a help at that level? Can he handle the level? I'm not really too sure. Henry Kessler and Auston Trusty are rewarded for good seasons with their clubs. Both of their clubs had amazing seasons, and both of them were key parts of it. I don't expect either of them to be involved with the national team much in 2022, especially with our center back depth. But I have no problem with their good performances in MLS being rewarded by being called into a December camp. Kobi Henry is a very interesting one. He's 17 years old, getting regular minutes in USL for Orange County. As we saw in Revelations Cup, he seems to be a very big, strong center back, but still needs to improve a lot with his feet. He's still just 17 years old and can definitely improve. You know, we don't really have a ton of strong center back candidates at the under 20 level. So I suppose I'm not too surprised to see Kobi Henry here, but I would have rather gotten a guy like Antonio Leone, who is still up for grabs, who's very much being courted by Mexico, and brought him into this camp. Although I don't hate Kobi Henry being here either, I'm generally a fan of giving youngsters an opportunity. Justin Che is somebody who didn't have the greatest Revelations Cup either. Since he came back from Bayern, it feels like he stagnated a little bit. He still has defensive lapses, specifically from a concentration point of view. But he's still young. He's 18 years old. And guess what? He's not a right back. I know that FC Dallas has been using him as a right back, and that is sometimes a development tool where they put a young center back at right back in order to give him experience and minutes in a less dangerous place for an inexperienced player. But I think we saw in Revelations Cup that he's not a right back. I mean, he played right back in the opening game and he was all over the place. And then they moved him into center back for the last two games and he just looked a lot more of a natural fit. It just feels like that is his position long-term. I hope we see him get some minutes in this camp as a center back, and we don't keep shunting him out wide. We need to develop young center backs under the age of 20 for 2026, and Justin Che could be one of those key guys. Let's not waste any time putting him in positions that don't suit him. Let's let him develop and grow into a good, strong center back for the program going forward. Midfield, oof, this is probably the roughest part of the whole roster. This is a very traditional American midfield. Lots of defensive players, lots of two-way players, no real creatives. Cole Bassett, like Auston Trusty, is rewarded for a very strong season. And I like Cole Bassett, but he really is more of a two-way box-to-box guy than a creator, somebody who can unlock a defense either on the dribble or with a pass. Jackson Yueill, terrible season for club and country, has never really showed to me any reason to believe that he should be on the national team. I mean, he was poor in Olympic qualifying. He was extremely poor in the Nations League semifinal. I don't know if people remember that game where we couldn't build through midfield against a terrible Honduras team because we had Sebastian Legette and Jackson Yueill just completely anonymous. And then he was still brought into the Gold Cup. He played against Haiti, and he was so bad that he never started again in the Gold Cup, and he never played a single minute after the group stage. Shouldn't he earn his way back rather than it just being handed to him? And by that, I mean, shouldn't he at least be a standout performer for San Jose before bringing him back inside? He doesn't even need to be here. If you already have Kellyn Acosta and Johnny Cardoso, why does Jackson Yueill need to be here? Do you really need three guys to play the six? And for people who say that he's maybe here to quote unquote teach the system, let me just say this. Somebody who has consistently failed to execute and perform in a system should not be teaching that system to anybody. So I don't know what Jackson Yueill is here, but he definitely fits into the Gregg favorites mold. And I think he will continue to get opportunities almost regardless of performance or talent. Johnny Cardoso is a guy who I'm hoping can challenge Acosta for that backup spot at the six. We talked about the left back backup spot still being open, and I think this backup six to Tyler Adams is still a question mark. You know, Kellyn Acosta has been inconsistent over the course of the year. Sometimes good, sometimes not. I still have question marks about bringing a guy like Acosta to a World Cup. The quality and speed of the game is going to be too much for him. If something happens to Tyler Adams, we're really stuck at the six. Can Johnny Cardoso fill that role? I don't know. He wasn't very good in Olympic qualifying. He has started to get more minutes in international now in Brazil, and I certainly want to give him an opportunity. I still have questions about the defensive side of Johnny Cardoso's game, a little bit like I do about Gianluca Busio. Is he a guy who can protect that back line? I don't know, but I'm glad he's in this camp, and hopefully we do get to see him. Roldan is here. I mean, he's been pretty good for Seattle this season, probably one of their better performers. Has never really performed for the national team, and I don't really see the point of seeing more of Cristian Roldan. But if you want to argue that his MLS form deserves him a December call-up, sure, I guess I can get on board with that. There were other midfielders who should have been here, but they weren't here for various reasons. Georgi Mihailovic is a guy who could have added a lot to this roster, but Berhalter said that because of his training stint in Bologna in Italy, they decided to let him go do that and not bring him in. Alan Signora, from what I understand, is a guy they wanted to bring in, but they struggled to get a release from his club in Argentina. Paxton Aronson is another guy I heard they wanted to bring in, but obviously Philly still has the playoffs, so they were not going to release Paxton Aronson, and that's perfectly understandable. Overall, with this midfield, I struggle to see where we're going to get any creativity from, and it'll be interesting to see who Gregg actually starts against Bosnia. Forwards, Cade Cowell, Caden Clark, Jordan Morris, Ricardo Pepi, Gyasi Zardes, Jesus Ferreira, and bizarrely, Taylor Booth. I have no idea why Booth is listed as a forward. He has been a midfielder for most of his career and has played a lot of games at sort of right back for Bayern too. He's kind of a small guy, but very good on the ball. An excellent distributor, very solid technically. I'm not sure what Bayern's plan is with him long term, but he's never played as a forward. So I don't understand why we've brought him in as a forward here. This just makes no sense to me, but what would a Gregg Berhalter roster be without categorizing at least a few guys as wide players who are clearly not? Caden Clark is another guy that is categorized as a forward on this roster. And while I'm happy to see him, I really think he's a lot more of a midfielder. He does most of his damage in that dual eight role. And he also provides a lot of work on the two-way. He's very good in the press. He's very good retreating to defend. He's had an up and down season, as most 18-year-olds will have. When he came back from his surgery, he wasn't quite the same player, but he's sort of been growing back into the role. One of the few guys in Revelations Cup that actually impressed me, and I really hope we see a lot of him against Bosnia. Cade Cowell has been up and down in MLS. He's a guy that still has a lot to improve technically, in my opinion, but he's young enough that he has time to improve. If Jordan Morris can improve technically in MLS, so can Cade Cowell. Speaking of Jordan Morris, he is finally back. This is his second major knee surgery. It will be interesting to see how he looks after being out for almost a year. I like Jordan Morris. He has made efforts to improve over the years technically, but I'm not sure he's going to be in Qatar. Either way, it's good to have him in this roster, give him another look, see what he can do. Jesus Ferreira is here as well, probably as a center forward. Gregg seems to like him as a false nine. I would so much rather play a guy like Jesus Ferreira in midfield. I just think he's a guy who, unlike any of our other midfielders, can pick a lock, right? Can actually break down lines with his passing, very technical. But of course, he is listed as a center forward. Zardes and Pepi are Zardes and Pepi. Zardes is a Gregg favorite and probably will be to the end of time. Pepi is getting a lot of slagging I've seen recently because he hasn't been that good in the last few games. Guys, we got to be patient with him. He's 18 years old. There's going to be variants of performance with Pepi. You know, sometimes when there's a lot of transfer talk around a player, it can turn their head a little bit. Their performances can drop slightly. I don't know if Pepi is going to transfer this January. There's a lot of conflicting information. There seems to be a lot of hesitation. There seems to be a very high price tag from Dallas. Whatever it is, I hope he can get sorted out because it's really important for Pepi to have a strong 2022 leading up to Qatar. Here's the starting lineup that I would like to see based on the positions that Gregg has these guys in. So I wouldn't play a lot of these guys in these positions, but based on where they're listed on the roster, I'd like to see Matt Turner in goal, Bryan Reynolds, Justin Che, Walker Zimmerman, and Jonathan Gomez as the back four. I'd like to see a midfield of Johnny, Ferreira, and Bassett. That would be Johnny Cardoso at the six with Jesus Ferreira and Cole Bassett as duo eights. Yes, I know that Ferreira is listed as a forward, But I don't want to see Roldan. I don't want to see Acosta. I don't want to see Yueill. I want to see the young guys. Up top, I'd love to see Morris, Pepi, and Caden. I'd be a lot happier with Caden Clark in midfield, but Gregg Berhalter clearly doesn't see him that way. And to be fair, he doesn't see Ferreira that way either. This is my wish list. If I can only use the midfielders in midfield that Gregg has actually listed as midfielders, I suppose I'd take out Ferreira and put Cristian Roldan there. But I think that midfield would struggle to create. Again, like I said, what's more important to me is who actually plays in this game than who's in this roster. All right, guys, those are my thoughts and opinions about this roster. Give me yours in the comments below. You guys have a great weekend. I'll talk to you soon.